Hello everyone, I'm Pooja and you are watching Med Talks with Dr. KK Agarwal Non-Stop Show 304th edition. Let's have the headlines of the day. Before I begin with the headlines, I would like to thank all of you for keeping him in your prayers and good wishes. Let's continue to pray together for his quick recovery. And now we go to the headlines. India's fresh COVID cases fall below 3 lakh mark for the first time in 25 days. 10,000 packets of DRDO's anti-COVID oral drug, 2-deoxy-D-glucose, to be distributed today. In view of the COVID pandemic, Chardham Yatra is temporarily suspended. Only rituals are being performed with no pilgrims allowed. China reports 25 new mainland COVID-19 cases. An experimental COVID-19 vaccine developed by Sanofi and GlaxoSmithKline showed a robust immune response in early stage clinical trial results. That's all for the headlines. Now let's go to the topic of the day.
Hello everyone. Our topic for today is ENT manifestations and mucormycosis. Let me introduce our special guest today. Today we have with us Professor Dr. Major Prasanna Kumar S. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you.
Professor Prasanna Kumar S. is a professor and senior ENT consultant with 20 years of practice in this specialty. After his post-graduation in ENT, he served in the Indian Army Medical Corps as a graded ENT specialist till 2004. He is presently working as a professor in the Department of ENT, Head and Neck Surgery at Sri Ramchandra Medical College, Chennai, and as a senior consultant at Apollo Specialty Hospital and senior consultant at Chennai ENT Research Center, Annanagar. His keen interests are in the field of aesthetic surgery of the nose, micro-ear surgery, endoscopic sinus surgery, head and neck surgery, and head and neck trauma surgery. His passion in airway-related surge propelled him to do extensive clinical surgical research work in the field of airway surgery. He is a keen academician with numerous publications and presentations in various journals and at conferences of national and international repute. He has bagged several awards and recognitions in the field of ENT, head and neck surgery. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Ruchika, Dr. Ruchika. Thank you, Dr. Pooja.
Before we go to the questions, sir, I think we should have your presentation first.
I will start my presentation and I'll try to be as brief as possible so that I can take more questions. So I'm just sharing my screen. Just tell me if you can see my screen. Yeah, my screen is seen.
Yes, now it's
full screen. Yeah.
But
any issues?
So we can't see the slides. We can see a folder.
Sir, can you open the PPT? Can you open the PPT then share it?
Yeah, the PPT is opened. I'll just share the screen. Sorry.
You have to screen the tab window. There's a window, the next option. You have to select the PPT and then press share, which
yes.
I told you.
Yes, right. Is it okay? Is it showing?
Yes, hello? Now yes, it is. Now we can see the slides.
Okay, right. So what I'm going to talk about today is COVID-19 manifestations in ENT. And this will be in special reference to the mucormycosis, which is called the black fungus. Now, most of us would have heard about this black fungus. It's been in news of recent because of the epidemic proportions of cases which are coming up with this infections. Before I just start off my presentation, I work in Ramchandra Medical College. This is where most of my academic work is being done. Today I will be just introducing COVID-19, the pathophysiology of COVID-19 in general, so that you can understand what actually is happening in relation to the fungal infection, give you a glimpse of fungal diseases in ENT, dwell into the spectrum of fungal infections in the nose and paranasal sinuses, and then I will be summarizing the mucormycosis or black fungus and how we go about managing it. Now, the new era of the COVID-19 has brought a lot of challenges, both in the medical fraternity, a lot of things which were not known, a lot of challenges in medical, scientific, social media, and also financial condition of the common man. The second week, second wave of this COVID has put the medical fraternity into a great pressure, and that too because of the post-COVID 19 sequelae, which is very commonly seen now. Now, just a glimpse on what this COVID-19 virus does. How does it cause problems? The initial problems are because of the direct viral toxicity. It also is proven to show cause endothelial damage or the blood vessel damage, the microvascular injury to the blood vessels. It also causes a dysregulation in the defense system, the human defense system, immune system, what we call. And third, it causes a hyperinflammatory state, probably hyperallergic, whatever you can call. And this leads to most of the complications of COVID-19. It also causes hypercoagulability, meaning to say the bloods tend to clot into the blood vessels and causes a lot of thrombosis. And these causes most of the problems. Then you have something called the angiotensin converting enzyme maladaptation pathway, which dysregulates the endocrine metabolism in the body.
Now, so you see. So your slides are not moving.
Is this now okay?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So if you see the early onset, when the symptoms occur, the acute infection, it's just viral replication. And most of the patient presents with fever, cough, dyspnea, myalgia, headache, sore throat, loss of smell, loss of taste, and all this. But as the things progress, exactly around a week or so, there are gastrointestinal, cardiovascular manifestations, sometimes neurological, and also muscular system manifestations. And now we are seeing ENT manifestations also in the form of mucormycosis or the black fungus. And the late complications which we see is breathing difficulty, dyspnea, and all this which have been documented in literature. Now I'm just going on to the what happens in ENT, that is the ear, nose, throat. Now, most common thing which I've seen during this COVID wave 1 and COVID wave 2 is there is an increased incidence of middle ear infection. This is mostly caused by a secondary bacterial infection. But some cases, we have seen sudden sensory neural hearing loss. There is sudden loss of hearing, which the patient reports. Usually occurs on the second week of this COVID infection. Some people present with tinnitus, that is a ringing or abnormal sound in the ear. And if treated early, the sudden sensory neural hearing loss or the tinnitus may be reverted, but sometimes it can be a permanent problem. So the main treatment for the sudden sensory neural hearing loss and for the ringing sensation or the abnormal sensation in the ear are steroid therapy. That can be you can consult the doctor and he can decide on that. A few cases of facial nerve palsy, that is weakness on one side of the face, is seen. That also needs steroid therapy, and sometimes if required later on, if it is not responding to steroid therapy, probably a surgery. We also have been seeing a lot of ear infections, the outer ear infections, and especially in elders, I've been seeing a lot of very virulent infections of the ear. We call this malignant otitis externa. And some cases of fungal infections are also being reported which is a virulent fungus which starts eating the flesh or the mucormycosis in the ear, also has been reported. Now, as far as the throat and the neck is concerned, most often people present to us with acute pharyngitis or laryngitis, that is acute inflammation in the throat. And most of the COVID patients have a persistent severe throat pain, probably because of the muscle spasm also there. And basically, the treatment is symptomatic. Over a period of time, they resolve along with analgesics. But then analgesics to be taken very carefully on the prescription of the doctors. Because in this COVID era, we are also seeing a lot of acute kidney injuries which occur because of increased use of analgesics. We are also seeing a lot of increased neck abscesses which are there. Now, nasal manifestation, one of the earliest manifestation of in the nose is loss of smell, and in the throat, throat is the loss of taste. Now, when a patient has a history of fever, loss of smell and loss of taste, it's invariably in this era we think about COVID. Now, COVID presents like a flu-like symptoms, so it has to be differentiated from other flus and allergic rhinitis. The tests are useful, and loss of taste, smell and loss of taste are a clue that you are possibly looking at a viral rhinitis. Then you have acute rhinosinusitis, that is a bacterial infection which superimposes on to the viral infection. And now what we are seeing is rhinocerebral mucormycosis. Now, this has reached epidemic proportions, and it's a black fungus. I will be dwelling into what this means, the rhino orbitocerebral mucormycosis. Now, before I go into that, I will just give you people a glimpse of what this fungus is. Now, fungus is a type of ubiquitous organism which is present all over the place. It's there all over the place. They are eukaryotes, and it's been described as early as 1929. When Alexander Fleming described penicillin, antibiotic which was derived from a fungus. Now, fungus are both saprophytic and a parasitic fungus. Parasitic fungus feed on living organism or dead cells. So, these fungus sometimes can also be called a killer fungus. And fungal infections generally, even before the COVID era, the invasive fungal infection affected around 4.9 million persons. And mortality of this fungal infection is actually similar to tuberculosis or more than that of malaria. So that is the amount of problem which fungus had created prior to this COVID era. Now it has come out with a vengeance. And if you see, the CDC has also shown out there are a lot of outbreaks of fungal infection which occurs in a specific area. And this is more so in India now. Now, if you look at the spectrum of fungal infections in ENT, we have subcutaneous and skin infections which can go through the skin and eat up the flesh. These are some of the cases which we have reported in some journal. They require a lot of debriding and aggressive management. Fungus also can present in the nose in the form of fungal rhinosinusitis, and they are of two types, the non-invasive type and the invasive type. I will only be dwelling into the acute invasive or fungal fulminant in mucormycosis. Now, this mucormycosis, if you know of fungus or mucor, this mucormycosis is an organism which likes iron. It needs iron or ferritin. Now, this mucormycosis is an angio-invasive fungus. It gets into the blood vessels and forms mucor thrombi, then causes necrosis, and then starts spreading. So what happens in COVID is the increased uncontrolled sugars, dysregulated immune system, and the increased ferritin level, all these predispose COVID patient for mucormycosis. Added on, humidified oxygen, high flow oxygen, which is given through the nose, sometimes cause nasal trauma, and also high doses of steroids, which are used, can also be implicated in these fungal infections. Now, how does a patient with a fungal infection present? Well, with severe facial swelling or a pain. So any patient, a COVID patient who comes with increased facial swelling or pain, we need to look at fungal infection. Nasal discharge, then if you look at the oral cavity, you can have ulcers in the palate. Then there is a lot of congestion around the eyeball. You will have edema around the eyeball, as can be seen in this picture. And the eyeball also stops moving. Sometimes there will be loss of vision, and also the eyelid will drool. And if it is going intracranially into the brain, then you have delirium and irritation. When you look into the oral cavity, these are some of the ulcers of the invasive fungus which can occur, the palatal ulcers, the lutes, teeth might be loose. Then you have the perforations which can go on, and the eyeballs, well, this is the drooping of the eyelid, and then the eyeballs will stop moving. So how do we diagnose it? We just have to look into the nose. We take a smear from the nose and send it on a KOH smear. Now this KOH smear, they can report it within 30 minutes in a centralized lab. We get it within 30 minutes. So just take a smear from the nasal cavity and send it for lab, microbiology lab, and they will show aseptic hyphae. And this confirms that there is a fungal infection. The moment you diagnose this, you need not wait for serology or molecular diagnostic, which takes a lot of time. Fungal cultures will take around 14 days to come. So if your KOH is positive, KOH smear is positive for aseptic fungus, then you need to rapidly start on treatment. And treatment is multimodal. It is not that only this person should deal with it, that person should deal with it, that specialist should deal with it. It is a teamwork. A teamwork of ophthalmologist, because the eye is involved, neurologist, it can go into the brain, neurosurgical intervention might sometimes be required. Physician play a very important role in controlling sugars, hydration, electrolyte balance, and also the renal functions. The main modality of treatment here for fungal infection, mucormycosis, is injection amphotericin B, which is available in conventional form and the liposomal form. We generally use the liposomal form because that is less toxic. Okay, and then if starting on the liposomal injections, we start doing debridement. That is, whatever the tissues are involved with the fungus, we remove those fungus tissues. We rapidly go on removing all this tissue and also give injection amphotericin simultaneously so that the infection is also controlled. Once the infection is controlled, we change on to oral posaconazole. That is also antifungal. Other antifungals are available, which can be used to treat this fungal infection. But the treatment should be aggressive. So if you identify this fungus or the fungal symptoms early, then you institute your treatment as early as possible. And thus we can actually prevent loss of eye, blindness. All this can be prevented. Even neurological manifestations can be prevented if you identify this disease early. That's my presentation. I have actually rushed up my presentation a little fast as possible so that you can go in for your questions. Thank you. Hello.
Thank you so much, sir. That was indeed quite insightful. We also have a lot of audience questions regarding this black fungus, as people are commonly calling it. So I would request you to first respond to the audience questions, and then we can go back to more on the topic. So one person is asking, my parents recovered from COVID at home with a short course of steroids. Are there any chances of them developing mucormycosis?
Yeah, There are chances. I told you, I actually dwelt into how this mucormycosis is formed. Now, diabetes is one of the predisposing conditions. And in COVID, we have seen the ferritin levels go high. So what I would request the audience to do is, if there is pain, painful facial swelling, immediately contact your doctor. So earlier that you diagnose a sinusitis, probably we'll ask for an X-ray or a CT. If you diagnose a sinusitis and if there is evidence of acute sinusitis, all that we can do is take a smear from the nasal cavity and send it. Within half an hour, we can find out, okay, we are dealing with this deadly fungus. And if at that time we intervene and we can actually provide good cure. If you delay the diagnosis, if it once enters the eyeball, it can just go on. It can go into the cavernous sinus, that into the brain, and then it can go into the brain itself. And then if it enters the brain, 70 to 80% of your battle is lost. For the past 1 week, I've operated around 6 or 7 cases of this COVID. And all of them have been picked up early. A few of them have gone into the eye and we had to actually remove out some tissues from the eye. We call it orbital decompression. And fortunately, today when I went back and saw my patients, their eyeball, the congestion, the edema, everything restored and the eyeball was moving. We are happy that we could save the eye. But some people are not fortunate enough. So if you have a persistent facial pain, headache, and also a eyeball swelling, it's immediately you need to report to the ENT consultant.
Right, sir. So, sir, somebody is asking how much time does the symptoms take time to appear from a fungal infection? And there's one more question. Is this infection possible in patients recovering in home isolation?
Yeah, I was discussing with my colleagues, and many of my ENT colleagues have told that even home isolation patients have come with COVID mucormycosis manifestation. Yes, it can occur. The first question which you asked was
how much time does it take for the fungus to show the symptoms?
See, the fungus is a very rapidly growing fungus. It doesn't give us much time. I told you it invades blood vessels. Once it gets into the blood vessels, it forms a mucor thrombi which can just embolize and can spread very fastly, causing destruction of tissues. It doesn't give you time. So if you have a severe facial pain, not to threaten anybody, but if it is a persistent pain throughout the day, please do not wait. The next day you go and consult the ENT surgeon.
Right. Right. And someone else is asking, are there any preventive medicines that can be taken to keep themselves safe from the black fungus?
I would say rather don't fiddle with your nose. Get your sugars under control. These are the two things which are very important, and probably your nasal hygiene is also very important, and the earlier it is detected, the better is the treatment.
Right. Ruchika, do you have any questions?
Yeah. So, sir, what would be the best way to manage nasal congestion?
Yeah, very important question. Now, nasal congestion is... In the beginning of a COVID infection, you generally have a nasal congestion. It also will be associated with the loss of smell, as I told you. So if you have a loss of smell and loss of taste, that means you're looking at COVID. So don't ignore that. You get into get a consultation. Now, COVID becomes very symptomatic in the first week, the end of the first week. So early symptoms are not much. You will have just a nasal congestion and all those. Where you can symptomatically treat with nasal drops, you have decongestant nasal drops, you have anti-allergic medications, and also steam inhalations. This definitely benefits your nasal congestion. Now, if you have a persistent nasal congestion and facial pain, please consult your ENT doctor.
Right, sir. So if I move a bit away from the fungus and come straight away directly to some ENT manifestations, does COVID-19 affect balance also?
Yes, there are a few cases which have been reported. I told you the sensory neural hearing loss. Now, if you look at the ear, you have two parts of the inner ear. You have a balance system and you have an organ of hearing. They are two separate systems which are there in your ear. Now, if there is a thromboemboli, I told you COVID predisposes to thromboemboli, or even the virus itself, a viral infection of the inner ear can cause sensory neural hearing loss and also loss of balance. And the earlier you detect it and treat it, it is better.
Right, sir.
So are there any differentiating signs and symptoms between a non-specific ear infection and a COVID infection, or during the current times we should consider all ENT manifestations as COVID right now?
No, see, COVID directly does not, even if it causes an infection, it's a viral infection, it will go off. Now, what happens is you have a superadded infections which are caused by bacteria and the fungus. Now, these are things which are going to complicate the situation. So, COVID directly causing a viral infection, except for the sensory neural hearing loss or loss of balance and abnormal perception of sound, that is, we call it tinnitus, you don't have a direct infection into the ear. And it's not as problematic as a superadded bacteria or a fungal infection.
Right, sir. So, sir, there is a huge scare among patients regarding mucormycosis. So what is the prognosis of mucormycosis? How many?
Yeah, very good question. Now, pre-COVID era, when we were operating, the mortality rate, the death rate, which has been shown in literature, has been around 30%. That is, out of every 100 mucormycosis infection, 30 people liable to die. Now, we did conduct a study. Last year, this study has been published in the Indian Journal also. And we did conduct a study. There are a few things which tells you what the prognosis is. Uncontrolled diabetic with a mucormycosis has a poor prognosis, especially when they come with acidosis, diabetic ketoacidosis stage. So when they manifest as a fulminant infection, there's a rapid progress of disease. That has a poor prognosis. And a second thing which has poor prognosis is this thromboemboli when it gets into the brain, the cerebrum. So if you have a lot of mucor thrombi which gets into the brain, it's very difficult to deal with these patients. So these are the two things which determine mortality. If you detect it early, as the palatal ulcer stage or just getting into the eye, the facial pain stage, if you know that this is there, yes, it can be controlled, it can be treated with success.
Right.
Okay. So in today's settings, what will you recommend to the healthcare practitioners for running their OPDs for non-COVID patients?
Yeah, very important questions. Now, the whole concept of how COVID is transmitted over this thing has changed from the first wave to the second wave. Initially, we were told it is a fomite transmission, that means it can be transmitted when somebody is actually sneezing or coughing. It goes on and then the droplets is there, it sits, and then it is transmitted from the droplets. When you put it, you put your finger to the nose or your throat, the COVID enters through that. And now it is changed on to aerosol. That means it just comes in the air, not as a droplet. Virus is just a particle, it's RNA or a DNA particle, which is very unstable in the outside world. It has a short life. Now, if it comes through aerosol, that means the most important thing which you people have to take care as a doctor is wear a mask which is N95. If you are operating or if you are actually dealing with the COVID patient, N99 mask is available. If not, a respirator is available. You need to cover that with your cover the face and the nose and the throat with the mask. That's the most important thing. Second thing is the face shield. Now, I have been seeing my patients on the outpatient department with face shields and also a respirator or a mask as the situation demands. And touch wood, nothing has happened. I mean, though I was peeping into the throat and nose, very careful that I don't bring my mask down. So the important thing is to use a proper mask, which is certified mask, N95, N99 or N100 mask with a face shield. The rest of the thing is the gown and all those is the second one. You need to protect yourself. Those aerosols should not be sitting there, and then after the patient goes, you touch your gown, your shirt, and then again put your hand into the nose, or you touch your nose or the throat. Those things should be avoided. Now, if you practice this, you are 100%, you're going to be safe. Second thing is, not in a consultation should not be in a closed room. And some doctors have a problem of talking to the patient for a long, long time. No. As short as possible, you got your diagnosis, ask them to wait outside. You can write your prescription, call them in, again give their prescription. A little bit of adjustment. Or if you can do the consultation in an open space, that should be doing a lot of good. If you are having a closed space, you are allowing a lot of attender inside, you are inviting trouble.
Right, sir. So since we are running short of time, I would like to thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Prasanna, for a very good session today. And I believe a lot of questions and a lot of problems, issues have been resolved for our audiences. Thank you so much for joining us today. Could you please show us the certificate, Manmeet?
Thank you. Thank you, Pooja. Thank you, Ruchika. Thank you. The MedTalk team. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir. So that will be all for today. We will be back tomorrow at 7 p.m. with another edition of MedTalks with Dr. K.K. Agarwal. Keep watching MedTalks with Dr. K.K. Agarwal. Namaskar.
Thank you.
Thank you.